An optimization similar to inlining as far as benefits are concerned is called function call inlining, and it takes code that calls a function, so we do some work, then we prepare the function parameters, for example, put them in the right registers according to the calling convention, then we call a function, and then we do more work after that, and when we call a function, let's say that the function itself was just adding the first two parameters and putting that in the return value and then returning. So this sends us back here, and then we continue with the more work. So this is what a normal function call looks like. So now we can try to avoid the overheads of calling the function and returning from it by doing our work. Then we don't have to prepare the function parameters anymore. Now what we do is we simply take the work of the function and just plug it in here. So in this case, we add up adding the registers, for example, that did contain the values that we eventually ended up passing here. So we didn't need to copy these registers to A0 and A1. And we put the result exactly where we need it, for example, R7, instead of having to maybe copy from RV to R7. And then we can continue with our work. So the first benefit of function call inlining is that it eliminates the calling and returning overheads, which include not only the function call instruction and the return instructions themselves, but also the code that prepares the function parameters according to the calling convention, and the code that possibly in the function itself needs to, for example, pop parameters from the stack and so on, and then possibly also the work here after we return to get the return value into the register where we need it. All of that can be done by simply inlining the function and then just using the registers we want. And just like loop unrolling, which helped scheduling do better, so does function call inlining. Because really what we have is, this is where we can do scheduling, and then we need to call the function, so these instructions cannot be moving around beyond this point. We can do scheduling here, but again, we cannot do much of this work before the call, and then the function itself can be scheduled, but we have to do it within this. We have three separate pieces of code, each of which can be scheduled, but we cannot, for example, take something from here and use it to fill an empty slot here. On the other hand, after inlining, this is just code with no function calls or anything, so now all of this work is schedulable. For example, the work from the function can easily be moved around, assuming that the dependency is allowed. So inlining also lets us do better scheduling, just like loop unrolling did, and for the same reason. Now we have more work that we can play with. Just like loop unrolling, the elimination of the overheads for calling, returning, and so on will reduce the number of instructions. The better scheduling will let us reduce the CPI, and that means that we can usually improve the execution time by quite a bit. The smaller the function, the more benefit from both of these. Because if the function is very small, the overheads of calling and returning are high relative to the work we are actually doing. And also, if the function is small, scheduling within the function is not going to do much. But if we put it into the existing code, suddenly this instruction here can probably be squeezed into an existing cycle without really adding another cycle. And finally, there is a downside to inlining, and it's very similar to what we had for loop unrolling.